Hello, today I want to talk about big data, which is a very kind of grandiose word. It's all the largesse of marketing, blah blah. And there is a bit of truth in that, as we shall see. On the other hand, it has a very sound, dry mathematical background to it. That's called data science, which we shall also have a look into that. So my personal background is in that field. While I might talk about a lot of things am not shy to share any kind of opinions and knowledge that I might have gathered over my life, this is something that I feel more confident of actually knowing things about because I really worked in that field for a long time. And I started two companies focusing on data science and big data. The one is Datarella, the name, of course, implying something like fairy tales with data, which, of course, was somehow ironic. And the second is Baltic Data Science, which is an agency dedicated to big data development and consultancy. My own life is very much connected to the rise of big data. If we look into the long-running trends here, you clearly see that I'm not so much an exception. It's just that I was riding a wave here. Since the 2010s, data science has increasingly become a thing. And at the same time, you see the traditional form of gaining knowledge through data, which, for example, is market research, dramatically decline. And I think this is, not an accident. We can also look at the Google search trends, and you see exactly the same pattern here. Over the last 5 years or so, data science has far outpaced people's interest compared to market research. So why do we have something like data science? I mean, people tell me, particularly me, I'm a statistician, so my colleagues, statisticians, in the least at the beginning of data science, so I always said, well, we have been doing data science all our career because statistics is basically nothing else than doing things with data. So why give it a new name? And that is a very interesting form of conservatism that we encounter here, because actually things have changed. So if you look into the maybe late 60s, early 1970s, there was also something happening that would create a new science, and that was computer science. So people at that time, I know, because when I was a child, that was still around. People who were mathematicians, whom I would know, and what I then later would read about, would look down on computer science. Same, the electrical engineers. I mean, they would say, well, computers, I mean, basically electrical engineering, and maybe there's a bit of math in the programs, in the software, but why create a new science for it? And the point is that at that time, around 1970, dealing with computers as objects of your study has become so complex and so important also for economy and society that it was worthwhile to having scholars and researchers dedicating their studies entirely on this field. And the same happened with data. And so data science is really complementary to big data. Nothing like big data existed before 2005. I mean, I think that is a fair claim, I'll show you why that was. But basically, in 2005, things really started to change in what data meant to value creation in companies, but also for political decision-making, surveillance, influence on society, and many other things. And also the global scale that came with the internet makes it worthwhile to look at data as objects of their own right. So if we think of what data actually means, so datum in Latin means something that is given. And the ancients 2000 years ago would use the word datum to set a date. So like for example, today's date, that is datum in its original form. So data is the plural of datum. So it is a set of many points of data that make together the data. So this is how the word comes to be, and it has not been in use for a long time. It is basically a word of the last 50 or so years, because it was used to describe the input of computers that is not just software. So in the early times of computers, people started to understand that computers take two forms of input. One is the software that they run, and the second is something else that the software transforms, and that is what they called data. And if you think of the data that computers digest, so to say, that they transform, that they calculate upon, that can be data in the form of tables, kind of lists that the computer processes, punch cards that the computer takes in, or any kind of input that people produce. But it can also be sensory data that directly feed into the computer. If you think of the Arduino, for example, transforming the analogous sensory data into digital data that the computer can process. So, big data, why is it big? I mean, I just Googled recent mentions of the term, and what you clearly see that we are at the petabyte scale of data that is produced on a daily basis. And that, I mean, is totally unprecedented. Never in history had there been petabytes of data, let alone petabytes of data every day in one company. So this is totally new. A petabyte of data is just unimaginably big. And that is, you can buy hard drives or small servers for quite little money that you have in your office that have petabyte space. So the petabyte was the threshold where data started to become really big. And if you see, I mean, these developments, I mean, here, like, for example, the Apple cloud, the iCloud, how is it run? I mean, it's amazing if you think of using an Apple and you click on your iCloud and it's immediately there. There is hardly any latency. And it's really interesting to think of what infrastructure that requires. And if you see the size of that, so in 2014, Apple was already at 75,000 Cassandra nodes. So Cassandra is a database system to process unstructured data. We will look into that a bit more. And would have like data in the size of tens of petabyte. And just in a decade, that has grown by an order of magnitude. So this means exponential growth. In a certain time, things double or things grow tenfold. And this makes the data really big and requires a totally different view on data. And I find this quote really meaningful that I picked up in a talk that I saw by Jeff Jonas, who at that time, I think, worked at Microsoft. And he said, why is it big data? We call big data when the information is created faster than my organization can make sense of it, so to say, with traditional tools. And I think this is a very meaningful way of seeing it. So just if you have a lot of data doesn't make it necessarily big data. If you think, for example, of Netflix, Netflix had always a huge program stock. So they have a lot of movies first in format of DVDs that they would send by mail and later on their servers. But the movies, I mean, you just have a catalog and you just look for a title and then the movies play. That's not big data. That is just a lot of data on really big servers. Big data is because Netflix processes more than a trillion events per day. A trillion events mean that people click or request or interact with their servers more than a trillion times per day. And that makes it big, because event processing is a totally different thing than looking something up in a catalog and then playing a video. Not that playing a video at scale is any simple task, but it is not so much a data science task. It is more streaming engineering, I mean, making your backbones worthwhile, having caches, video servers that are distributed over the earth so that the latency wherever you sit is not too big. But the big data comes in because it is very complex. People interact with Netflix in all kinds of way. People try to break it. There is fraudulent interactions. There is attacks on it. The geo-blocking, for example, which is a horrible thing. So Netflix shows you totally different things here in the Emirates, for example, than you would see in the US or in Europe. Which is very hard, actually. So you pay your money to a company and think you get all their stock, but it is really depending on where you are, if you get the full thing or only a part of it. So to process that and to prevent people from circumventing that, Netflix has a lot of data science running. So, and of course, it's not only in the corporate world, it is also the sciences who take a lot of data in and do things in a different way. And the first endeavor for that, that really changed how data was processed, was CERN. So CERN is the European large accelerator facility around Geneva. So it is situated in Geneva between Switzerland and France. And I think like something like 3,000 researchers permanently work at CERN. So it's a huge, I think it's the largest research facility in the world. And the point is that with the Large Hadron Collider, which is a multi-kilometer ring that accelerates hadrons, which means heavy particles, in particular, I mean, it accelerates hydrogen nuclei, protons, and let these protons hit each other at almost the speed of light. And by these huge energies that it creates, a lot of things happen. And what happens is that all kinds of products of this collision scatter around in a three-dimensional way and also in time. So you have a kind of spherical detector around the collision point, and you have to, first of all, to measure what is happening. I mean, all the particles that are created in this collision, and then you have to process this data. And that means billions of collisions per second. That creates such an amount of data that you can't do it the classic way. You can't look at every event by itself. You have to decide in the moment what happens with the data, if you discard it or if you keep it. And you have to abstract for it, otherwise it would just not be possible to handle that. And the data science that has been created around that, of course, helps in many, many other fields. One here is astronomy, and like doing things with data collected over billions of stars. The same, of course, is true in advanced chemistry, in particular biochemistry, in understanding, for example, the chemistry of proteins, which are composed of hundreds of thousands or millions of atoms. So this is what data science does. Data science enables us to deal with more data that we could anyway handle with traditional methods. Traditional methods means that we look at each point by itself and that we use tables to process the data, that we use traditional math and statistics to deal with the data. And of course, it has a very dark political side also, because all the data that we create accidentally in using our smartphones. I mean, here the smartphone is a super powerful sensory platform. It contains more than 20 different sensors that continuously measure who we are. I will talk about that in the studio part of this lecture. And all this data doesn't go unnoticed. And there is a lot of talk that companies like Google or Facebook abuse the data to make kind of unwarranted assumptions about the users. But it is, of course, also the governments. And a lot of that has been disclosed in detail by Edward Snowden several years back in his publication of NSA documents that show you how deep into people's private life this surveillance via data goes. So traditionally, organizations like the NSA or the British communication headquarters would be called signal intelligence, SIGINT, because you would measure signals, for example, radio signals, and try to make sense of what you read. I mean, the communication might be encrypted, and then you need bright people to crack the code, or you need not so bright people, but brutal people to torture out the keys and then out of the people who knew, and to extort that from people. So this is how traditional signal intelligence works. You bug things. But no, it has changed. We have what is called open intelligence. Open intelligence doesn't necessarily tap into people by bugging things, by tapping phone lines or anything. It just gathers what is already there, like the data that sits on Google servers, the data that sits on Facebook servers, the photos that Apple collects, and analyzes this data that is basically just sitting there as a spillover, and by that creating a totally new form of surveillance that is really scary because it is so totalitarian. And I mean, this is something that we have never faced before. The key understanding of data science and big data is that it is about the totality of it. It is not just, for example, measuring the temperature in your industrial process, for example, the room temperature, and have the AC being adjusted. It is measuring everything that you can get hold of and then making models out of that to understand what was going on and to predict what was going on and then to change the parameters. So instead of, for example, just having the AC running on the temperature in the room, you would also include like how many people are in the room, what time of day it is there noise in the room that would indicate that people are very active, or is it very quiet? How is the power consumption in the room that would indicate, for example, that machines are running or that people are working, and so on. So you would gather a lot of other data to understand what is actually happening in that room and would learn from that and automatically then train your model to become better and better in understanding what is going on. And that started, of course, in industrial processes, in particular in media processes like in advertising and content management on social media, but now more and more takes over on all kinds of traditional processes. And I think it is really important to understand the deep ideological, theoretical, and methodological differences that has from traditionally dealing with data in the normal kind of old school way with statistics. So the example that I always like very much to give is this map. I mean, you look at that and you immediately see It is some kind of, it looks like a satellite image, or kind of if you fly at night over a city. And I mean, if you look on the details, I mean, you recognize the city that it is, or you might at least. I mean, it is Berlin. So I mean, if you look, so you see the horizontal line going into the bright center of Berlin Mitte. That is, of course, the street Unter den Linden, and then it crosses with Friedrichstraße. And you see Potsdamer Platz, where the Sony Center is, for example. And a bit down to the southwest, you see Potsdam, the city next to Berlin. And the more residential places are a bit darker. But the interesting thing is, so this is actually, this is kind of an art project that the data scientist Eric Fischer did about 10 years ago. So what Eric Fischer did is he didn't use any geographical data to create this map. He collected images on Flickr with their geolocation that electronically created images almost always get imprinted on. So if you take an image with your phone, for example, or a contemporary digital camera, the metadata that is added to the image itself is not only the exposure time, time and date of when your photo was taken, the operation system, the type of camera, and so on. All this data goes with the photo as the metadata. No, it is also the latitude and longitude. And if you just read that out and put orange dots wherever, on a grid basically, wherever a picture was taken, you suddenly see out of nowhere the structure of a city emerge. So you don't need a map to reconstruct the city. You understand it just by people's behavior imprinted in what is called the metadata. The blue dots that are a bit scarcer here in Berlin are geolocated tweets. So, in a way, that tells you where things happen, where people have conversations, versus where things are that people find worth taking pictures of. And if you think of these places that are particularly bright, where thousands of people take pictures, you see that the content of the picture is actually not interesting. I mean, you know how the things, these tourist sites look like. You can just look them up in Wikipedia or Google them. And I mean, there's thousands of pictures of, for example, the television tower in Berlin, or the Brandenburg Gate, or the parliament, the Reichstag, and all these sites. They look all the same. It's just different people in front of them kind of smiling and waving. So the information, and that is one of the primary paradigm shifts in big data, is not in what usually was called the content of the data, the image. The image is not interesting. It is the metadata. So, and the metadata, I mean, it's called metadata because people really didn't think of it as so important. It's just in case you need to kind of categorize things or so, then you look it up. You just want, for example, data that was taken on a certain type of camera also. I mean, if you think of photographic archives, they were usually structured by telling, well, these are pictures from Berlin or whatever, and they show the Brandenburg Gate with people in front of it or whatever. We don't care about these things here. We just are interested in the metadata. So we completely reverse the view on data. Here's another one by Eric Fischer. Some of you might recognize this city as well. This is a different approach to the same idea. It's Warsaw, Warszawa. So you have in blue pictures on Flickr where the location of the people, I mean, where they say they are based, is the same. So this is people from Warsaw taking people, taking pictures of their own city, versus the red dots, which are people from other places taking picture in Warsaw. And you immediately see that, for example, I mean, this is 10 years ago, that was the construction of the S8 motorway that people find obviously worth making picture of. So you see the motorway going up here. And then you see other places, like, for example, the stadium. There's not many tourists in the Warsaw Stadium. It is basically locals taking pictures of the games happening there. The same as the Skaryshevsky Park. And then you have the places where it's mainly tourists taking pictures, which is in particular, of course, the old city, the old downtown of Warsaw, where the tourists go. And the locals actually don't find that worth taking pictures so much. And so you see people's behavior unfolding by using data science without asking them where they are from, without making any further assumptions on the data. It just emerges as structure. And one thing that basically, and in a way, kicked data science off around 20 years ago, people started. So when I did my thesis, like 25 years ago, in the mid-90s, I did my thesis on neural networks for statistical pattern recognition. So what I realized is that, first of all, I didn't find the math behind the neural networks that great, but more the problem was that there was never enough data to train the neural networks. So it was always totally arbitrary. I mean, you would say, well, in theory, the neural networks is probably very interesting, but you never have enough data to make sense of it. And around 20 years ago, so that changed because there were, for example, electronic documents like Wikipedia that didn't exist at that time yet, but I mean, similar kind of huge databases of text. And so people started to work with text and try out different algorithms. And the interesting thing, what this was the first paper, I think, that made that claim, and lots of these papers followed, and still people are working on that, is basically your method doesn't matter. As long as you have sufficiently many data, any statistical method that you apply to it comes to the same conclusion. So, and this, of course, leads to some kind of sloppiness in terms of the methods. So it's a good enoughness, because you can never become any better than the data that you have, so to say. If you have enough data, your method can be really kind of crappy and still lead to reasonable results that totally outdo what you could do with traditional statistics. So, and out of that come two major implications. That is, you always look at all the variables. You never discard anything just because you think it's just metadata also. That was the learning number one. And the second is, you always analyze all the data. You don't take samples if you don't have to. You try to get as much and then deal with the problems of that, like biases or so, later. So we have data science as a thing of its own right, and now look into what data science consists of. So first, we have to think of architecture. These huge amount of data, like these multi-petabyte of data, require totally different approaches to storage and computation. You can't run that on your normal a desktop computer, even if the desktop computer now is like 1,000 times more powerful than 25 years ago. So even if computers have become really powerful, you will never get a desktop computer that can do what you need to do for data science. So you come up with new architecture paradigms. So you have your data stored and you know how to process this. Now comes the point that the data is very messy. So you have all kinds of things in your data that would never occur in normal statistics. So in normal statistics, for example, if you give people questionnaires and they tick off boxes, there is nothing like malformatted data. I mean, the questionnaire could look ugly or so, but I mean, then you discard it, but that is a manual process. You look at the questionnaires and you just count how many people ticked what box. And the same is for many other forms of traditional handling of data. So dealing with noisy and messy data, in data science, it's much closer to what it is in electrical engineering, in dealing with noise in radio signals, for example. So you have all kinds of messed up information, like missing values also. So certain populations, for example, people of certain gender, or people of certain race, or people with, you will never know why, might not give you the data in the same way that other people might. That might just be technical. For example, people with iPhones give you much less data than people with Android phones. That might be just people with kind of off-the-shelf Samsung phones give you much more data than people with imported Huawei phones. And all these things. And behind that is hidden variables, because the people who buy Huawei phones might just be different from the people who buy Samsung phones, but you will never know, out of your data at least. You have to do secondary research to understand that. So you have kind of the problem that a lot of data is at various different levels of quality. So there might be data that is completely messy, then there might be data that is incomplete, and then there might be data that is dubious. And you have to find your way through that. And then comes all the technical problems of measuring data that you know from physical computing. I mean, if you do physical computing, all the sensors that you use create different forms of data, and you have to normalize it. You have to understand, for example, that the sensors, if you think of a temperature sensor or a pressure sensor or whatever sensors you use and connect to your Arduino and put into your physical computing setup, they produce different outputs just because they are technically different. And then you have date formats. All over the world, people use totally different conventions in how they encode dates and time. You will never know by looking at the data as such if the time zone is, like, for example, British time or UTC, which most of the time looks kind of the same but isn't. So unless someone tells you, well, this data point was on a server that is in UTC, or this was on a phone that is in British time, you can't see by just looking at the data. And all these things require a lot of thoughts. And the data munging, as it is called, I mean, getting rid of all the things that make it difficult to deal with it, to kind of normalize things, and then the data pre-processing and understanding what might be the difficulties in your data. You don't learn anything yet. You don't make any assumptions, you know, you don't build your models on that. It's just preparing the data so that you can actually use it. In my experience, that is about 85% of the work and the costs. So if you have a project that has a budget of $100,000, you can as well say, well, like 80 to 90,000 of that is just getting the data to a point where we can start looking at that. And this is how you have to prepare your business plans also, because clients usually will not understand that. They will be very impatient because they say, well, I have great data here. Please tell me what's in it. And I say, well, we have to work for like a year and a half until we can actually start, because your data is totally messy. And that's always how it is. I have never experienced it any different. And then comes the finally, I mean, the step that creates value. That's the step for which you are paid. And that is the analysis and the interpretation, which are separate steps. So first you analyze the data, and then you make sense of it. And then comes the most important step, you build a model from it to generalize. And that these steps are separate. Each step is in itself problematic. In each step you make assumptions and imply things. And it's very important to understand what you are implying, what are your assumptions in analyzing an interpretation. And the model is basically arbitrary. It's not totally random. You can't build any model from data. You can't have, if you think of prediction, for example, you look at people's shopping behavior and predict what someone might want next. That is not totally random, but if it is more conservative or more adventurous, or if you weigh some outcome of that decision more than another, is arbitrary. It is your decision. And as working with data, that is a decision that a data scientist, that you working with data, will have to make in a responsible way, because no one understands that. Only the person who builds the model will know what they are doing. And it's very hard to document that properly. If you think it's difficult to properly comment code, it is like so much more difficult to actually make explicit what you put into model development. Like, this is a regression model on my data, and I chose to include these things at these weights because, and then give your assumptions. Usually, assumptions are not that great. You just tried like 15 different models or 1500 different models and chose the ones that you kind of feel worked the best. But to make that explicit is one of the key features of being good at data science. And then finally, data science gets into products. That's also different from statistics. So the end result of a statistics, of doing statistics for companies or governments or so, is a report. So you have a report that says, well, this is what we've done, and this is what's in the data, so to say. While with data science, you usually think of that is only a step towards getting something that is a product, for example, features in your app, or features in your online shop, or features in your governmental services. So you are not interested so much in the report, but in what it does with your product. So, and as said, it's difficult, and you see, if you walk through the world with open eyes, kind of the problems are called data gremlins, because they lurk there and come out to get you all over the place. I mean, this is just randomly when I was in London last time, and I'm making this picture. I mean, you see clearly here the route is unknown to no data. I mean, you can't really imagine what happened. Something broke. Some data format is no longer feeding into that. The API didn't work or whatever. Very often you see Venn diagrams. So a Venn diagram is a set theoretical, or in the logics, a way of making things visible. And you have the set is always a circle, and then you have the intersections of the circle to understand what's in. And in the intersection of these three circles, you have big data. So it's kind of in the triangular middle. And in a way, that doesn't make any sense, because what's in the intersection between volume and velocity? Is that then less big data or whatever? I mean, it is always good to have that in your slides, because it impresses people a lot. So this is the three V's that define big data, just that you have seen them. This is another great Venn diagram that I made this picture in a conference, and then here's the... It's Drew Conway, is a data science, was like also about 10 years ago or so. He said, well, here there's these three kinds of people. There's these people that are statisticians or have math knowledge, and then there's the experts, and the intersection of that is the traditional market research. And then you have the statisticians who know how to code, and these are the neural network and machine learning people. What I never really understood is the people who can code and have expertise, that's the danger zone. I mean, I understand it in a way. That's people who hack together their code, but they don't know the statistics. I mean, that's the people working at Google, basically. They have no idea about social sciences. They have no idea about the implications, what they are doing. They just find it great, and then out comes some kind of totally horrible thing. Or at Facebook. I think this is why he called it danger zone. And the intersection of these three things is, what he says, is data science. Here's another Venn diagram that is kind of in the same spirit. I mean, there's the people who have heard the word big data recently and call themselves geeky and work in marketing. So, and in the middle of that is people who use a Venn diagram. I mean, certainly I am that type. I fulfill all these requirements. And then finally, there's my favorite one. I mean, clearly someone has seen Drew Conway's bubbles and says, well, actually, the intersection between the hacking skills and the substantial expertise is not that dangerous in the end. And then you have other, like, for example, the people who are experts in their field and are really evil, that is the James Bond villain. They know really what they do, but it's really hard. I mean, because they lack, for example, the hacking skills. And you go further up, and it's kind of the intersection between the hacking skills, expertise, and evil. That's kind of the people who run these botnets, who do online identity theft and fraud and so on. And then, I mean, in the center of it all, I mean, being really evil, but having everything else also, is of course the NSA. I mean, is the totalitarian surveillance. Yeah, generally, I noticed early on that data science is in a way very lighthearted. So I felt very welcome being among data scientists on conferences and generally, because I think what I found very meaningful is exactly this acknowledgement of social context. So good data scientists are not just statisticians who know the implications of model building. They are also good in understanding computers to some extent and can code, but they have also the expertise in their field. And I think this combination made it always very nice for me to be there, despite all the political problems that were there from the beginning. So it's just a few conference t-shirts, and you see clearly that people like making fun of their profession. And now, I mean, just a nice categorization on the way we deal with data. That's also very classic, but I mean, maybe you understand really the step towards big data. So there's things we know, that's the known knowns. And things we know that we don't know, that's the known unknowns. And then there's these things that we have no idea that they even exist. And Avinash Kaushik, who at that time, I think when he published his paper on that, and gave this talk, was the president of the American Mathematical Society. So he's really a good scholar. So he says, well, these known knowns, that is creating a dashboard, which he called data puking. So a dashboard summarizes what you know about, for example, your company or your government. So it kind of puts together things that you track, that you already know. And the known unknowns is where you use modelings, that is regression. So you know something might be there, like, for example, the spread of a new disease. So you have to look into data and find clues for that and then extrapolate and make your model. But the really interesting thing is the things that you don't know even exist, and that is the things that are slumbering in your data, by which you take all your data and look for things not by asking questions, not having a hypothesis. And that's the difficult thing, because in not having a hypothesis, everything just becomes a correlation. And many things might just be there randomly. And it is really tempting to accept these random correlations as something that has real value. And then also favorable is Žižek deconstructing Rumsfeld's quote and says, the problems is in particular the things that we don't know that we know. And these are all our prejudices. This is everything that we put into the data that we actually shouldn't. That is all the, in particular, sexism, racism, all the inequality that we just accept that the data just reaffirms. That is all the people who take, for example, educational attainment and look how well people do compared to how their parents did and say, well, I mean, obviously, their parents were in a bad spot and the children are too, that must be genetically determined, therefore. I mean, that's a typical conclusion that people make that kind of perpetuates racism, and that is exactly how Francis Galton 150 years ago came up with this kind of statistics to prove that people would be generally unequal, and not acknowledging that it was society making them unequal and giving privileged people much better access to education, for example. This is just an example of how dangerous it is not to know about your ideological biases, and everyone has those. There is no one free of that, and it's very hard to see them if you are not doing hypothesis-driven research. So now we move to go into the first of our four steps of data science. The first is architecture. And one of the things in architecture is that we look into the way we use to use databases. So as you know, SQL and any kind of SQL-like database language usually has kind of four basic ways of interacting with the data. So we can create new data and we can read from that data and we can modify the data and we can destroy the data, delete a record, for example. And in particular, if you combine select and delete, I mean, you can kind of end whole populations in your data. And one of the basic ideas of data science is to stop that. As far as it is possible, to stop thinking of data being updated and stop being of data being mutable. So this is, of course, in the ideal world that would be the case. In reality, that might face various difficulties. For example, data protection, where people have the right to be forgotten and can just request their data from being deleted. Then, of course, you have to have some means. But you get the point, maybe. Instead of thinking, for example, someone has an address and someone moves and you have to change the address, you just think of the whole combination of name and address as being one data set, and the next is just another data set. And you have to understand that it is no longer the same person, so to say. It is the same name, it is in a way probably the same person had moved, but data-wise, it is a different person now. And you try to make sense of changing data in having more data records instead of updating the ones you have. And having these kind of immutable databases is a huge step to prevent data from becoming inconsistent. In particular, if you used to work with SAP, which probably none of you has yet, except that, for example, this university's bookkeeping system seems to run on SAP, you know how difficult it is to have kind of a traditional table record based database system that always breaks. You can never keep that consistent. If anything happens, if, for example, some country just chooses to change the logic of their zip codes, you have a major IT project running in kind of making sense of that and adding new characters or new digits to the zip code. And this is also when you have these rigid forms that require you to fill out everything. And I mean, as a business, you actually don't want that. You want things to be very smooth. You want customers to be comfortable, even if they make a mistake. For example, they mistype something or so. So you don't discard that. You don't think that was wrong. You rather learn from it and say, well, obviously, maybe the form is not perfect because people make these mistakes all the time. Things that you would never learn about your system if you just discard the malformatted inputs. So this is one first idea of what is different in terms of the infrastructure. So you keep everything. And records are files. They are no longer lines in a table. So they are basically JSON files. They are JSON formatted text files. And each record is a new file. Yeah, how would you process that? That has also a name. It's the so-called Lambda architecture, and I'll lead you through that. And that is kind of, I think, that's the key paradigm of big data architecture. So I think this is really worthwhile looking into it a bit more detail. So first of all, the way people think of data is usually now in a stream that's continuously flowing. So and a faucet is often used to illustrate that. So what you have here is your sprout. And the sprout spits out data, as I say, all the time. It's these tiny JSON files that contain, for example, your web server access logs or your phone sensory data or whatever. Your images posted on Instagram. So that's the data that flows constantly in. And I mean, of course, you want to make queries on that. For example, you want to use your Instagram app and see the pictures that your friends posted. So that is a database query. Your app sends a query that says, find the pictures of people this person follows. But to query all the data, I mean, takes forever. It's unstructured. You will never find anything. With these petabytes of data in particular, I mean, that would never come to any results. So long time ago, people used batch computing to create high-performance databases out of this raw data. So you have your high-performance pre-computed view. That means that you have these lists, probably, of recent posts of your followers, of the people you follow, and pre-computed, so it's very fast to access them. However, creating these batches of the newly arrived data takes time. And in the case of social media companies, that might take up to a whole day to process yesterday's data. So you might have to wait a day until your data is really processed, until you can query it in an efficient way. And this is why we split the data. I mean, it is electronic data, so you can just copy each event. I mean, the one gets into storage, the other gets into what's called the streaming processing. And that is the real-time view. The real-time view is more limited because you have to predefine all your queries. You have to think of what is the things that people really need to know now in a very timely fashion. And that's what you put into the upper branch of this Lambda. I mean, the Lambda is a bit of a square. I mean, a bit it looks, you know, like the whole thing, I think, is meant to be, it is at least what the inventor of that told me, like 10 years back or whatever, it's supposed to look like a lowercase Greek lambda letter. So this is the lambda architecture. This is almost all big data installments that run today are in that architecture. And if you want to know what software to use, fast processing of incoming events is done with a messaging service. It's called messaging service because it was originally programmed to deal with messages. And you can think of any event, any kind of data event that comes in as a message. So that is a lot of pre-processing that takes place here in Apache Kafka. And then you have your big vault, that's your big unstructured lake of data. That's also metaphors that people use, the data lake. So your water runs into this bucket of all data and your lake kind of keeps it all. It never runs full, so to say, because it's only tiny text messages anyway. And the software on which that runs is Apache Hadoop. So Hadoop was more or less invented in 2005 by people who used to work for Yahoo at that time. It was invented to solve a problem that social media and search companies at that time started to face. And it is that there was no hard disk space that was big enough. Even the most expensive hard disks could not deal with the data that would be coming in. So you needed to invent something that creates a virtual hard disk that is arbitrarily large. So this is the first thing that Hadoop does. Hadoop combines really cheap hardware. You don't need any special hardware. You buy the cheapest computers that you can get. They're totally fine because Hadoop also creates redundancy. So if one of your computer servers fails, that's not a problem because you have redundancy between them. So you have thousands probably, or millions even in the terms of Amazon, for example. Amazon Web Services, the largest cloud provider, they have millions of computers running, really cheap computers, most of them I think produced still by Dell. They sit in shipping containers that are climatized and have a small a power supply. And the shipping containers are just stacked one on each other. Each contains 1,000 servers. And they're basically sitting on parking lots. And if a third of these pizza box shaped computers has burned out, service is automatically called and exchanges the whole box and refurbishes the computers. So this is a really new thing that Hadoop brought to companies, that is dealing with huge amount of data on super cheap hardware, on mainstream hardware, not on specialized servers. So Hadoop does a second thing also. It not only combines the storage, it also in a way combines the computation. So Hadoop has a very smart way of distributing certain kinds of calculations on arbitrary many CPUs. And you can, if you use Amazon Web Services, just click how many CPUs you want to have running, and of course it gets more expensive the more you take, and that that can, in particular, things like lookup of things in tables, like finding certain combinations of words in a huge amount of data, or sorting things, like sorting, for example, through a huge amount of data alphabetically, and things like that. These tasks that don't require the results to come in a certain consecution, but where you can kind of divide the data up and process each batch in its own time and then recombine it, these run very well on Hadoop. These are called MapReduce. It's a bit too far now to explain that fully, but you keep that in mind. So Hadoop is a MapReduce platform. And Hadoop is basically the technology of this lower branch, and then you run all kinds of databases on Hadoop, like Hive, for example. I mean, they have all kinds of funny names. And very interesting is the upper branch. So for the upper branch, you use Apache Storm. Storm was a product that was initially built for Twitter. So Twitter had these huge amounts of messages coming in and had to find a way to process them in real time. And at Twitter, it was where Storm was developed and then brought into the open in the Apache Foundation. And then you have Apache Spark. Spark is the most powerful analysis platform, where you can have automized data science running on your data. So and you can think of Spark in particular in combination with Python as being the easy way to access your data and make analysis on it. Just like in the old days, people would have used Microsoft Excel. Here's just, I mean, how that looks like in Twitter. So this is a few years back, but I think it hasn't changed much. The infrastructure on which Twitter runs, and so you see these various names here, like key value store. What does that mean? For example, a key value store is exactly JSON. So JSON means that you have a key, and each key has values. And the advantage of that is that you can build, as we shall see in the studio lesson, very complex data structures that don't require to be all the same. So you can be very flexible in what you accept. And then, of course, there's a lot of Hadoop and other databases. And then Mesos, so Mesos is kind of the middleware that that runs the Lambda structure. One thing that the social media companies really perfected, and that is now everywhere in data analysis, is A/B testing. So once you have all your data and so much and so many users, you can analyze things in a different way. So by that, we enter the third stage. So the first was architecture. The second is data pre-processing. Now we are in the analysis and interpretation phase. And one way of analyzing data is just to try different things. So for example, you have miniature changes in how your ad looks. And then just measure how these changes play out. And one of the interesting things in big data is that you don't decide that there is a psychological model behind it. For example, you have here the left-hand side ad has a background where things are going on, and the right-hand side is just a unicolor background and it's easier to read. But beforehand, I mean, in doing A/B testing, you don't have the hypothesis that the right-hand side might score better because it's easier to read, or the left-hand side might score better because it has more stickiness, there's more going on it. You just don't think like that. You just have as many different motives for your ads as possible and just try out which performs better. And you never think that it is more than just a correlation what is happening. So just because the ad works better now doesn't mean it will work still better in 2 weeks from now. Because people might just change and your competition might just change. So you keep it very agile and change it all the time. And that is what search companies, what social media companies always do with their apps and their sorting algorithms. So what the company decides is relevant for you, which is of course an arbitrary decision, is only based on what's keeping you more to using the app, what makes you more interactive, what makes you use the app longer and don't leave the app also. And everything that fulfills the task will just be more or less, I mean, like mindlessly deployed. I mean, there is no thinking of, well, people might like to use this feature because it's actually useful, you would never think like that in a big data setting. You would always just think, this is our target metric, which is, for example, stickiness or interaction, click-through rate, or whatever you call it. And anything that serves that purpose will just be used. And it continuously will be challenged. So you will always have new things to be tried out at a subset of your users. So when you use any of the social media companies like Instagram, sometimes you have the feeling that the app behaves differently now than it used to. Or you download an update of the app and the app has suddenly changed its appearance a bit. For example, instead of the post button, it was the little cross down at the Instagram app, you find now something like buy this product, and the post button has moved somewhere else, and then you wonder, I mean, what's the logic behind that? And clearly Instagram measures that and thinks of the target metric no longer being stickiness or how many pictures get posted, but how much do they sell. And if the new design actually works better than the old design, I mean, they will see and then decide. So this is the agile way of seeing big data. And by the way I phrase it, you see that it has a huge advantage. There's a lot to earn here, but it has also huge dangers. And because it completely denies the sovereignty of people, it completely makes people depending. Another interesting thing, and we will be much more into that in the session on labor and exploitation, is crowdsourcing. So one company that has become particularly notorious for that is again Amazon, which is the largest cloud computing provider anyway. So you can hire people to do your machine learning training tasks, and that's called crowdsourcing because it is not machines working for you. It's not that you click and have more CPUs and more storage running. It's actually people paid very little money, most of them not in the West but in the global South, earning pennies for doing your work. It's a new form of exploitation taking place. Another way of crowdsourcing is less exploitative. Here is an example of Kaggle. So Kaggle is a platform where companies put out challenges. For example, the challenge that this stockbroker has put out to come up with a better stock market prediction algorithm. And it's a competition, so you can earn up to $100,000. And I mean, if you look anytime on Kaggle, there is a lot of companies offering you money like that. And so you can do a lot lot of these competitions and try to earn your money there. I mean, some are not as difficult, some is more like less competitive, but more like crowdsourcing, and you might not get as much money, and you can always see if it is worthwhile. So this is an interesting new way of dealing with data. So you publish at least part of your data and say, please come up with a model that works better than the model that we just have. So one way in looking into analytics a bit deeper that I want to introduce to you is network analytics. So a network of data means that we have nodes. Nodes are usually what we think of as people or objects. Like, for example, nodes could be the items in your product catalog. If you think of an online shop, each node could be one of the things that you offer. And the edge is some kind of relation that you define between the nodes. For example, the edge between two nodes could be this person has sent a message to the other person. And then you see that these edges are usually directed. They can go either way or both ways. Not necessarily. I mean, there might be undirected networks, but usually in the data that we deal with, you have these edges having a direction. That's called an oriented graph. So, and if we look at how we can define kind of the matrices on the networks, how we can learn, we start looking at the first measure, that is the in-degree. So in-degree would, for example, be how many followers do you have? And if you think of each person is, does this person follow me? So you see, basically, there's people who get a lot kind of coming in, and these get a higher metric. And there's people who receive less, like, for example, these dots that only have one person following them, they receive, they have a smaller dot. So this is one typical metric. This could also be the numbers of messages you get. For example, the numbers of emails you get. So if you have a team, we shall look into that a bit more in detail. That is a good way to see, I mean, kind of who is in the center, I mean, who needs to be addressed, and who is more in the positions of having to ask. Then a second is the opposite, is the out degree, is how many messages do people send out. So if you think of, like, for example, an organization, there might be parts of the organization like HR or facility management that send a lot of messages out. I mean, they send basically messages to everyone in the network all the time, at least like one or two times a day. And then they receive in return much, much fewer messages. So, I mean, I send much fewer messages to facility management than I receive. And so this is the out degree. How many things does a node send out? And here you see the green point send out 4, while the red, for example, the small red dots send out 0. So they have the very small dots. And there is this a bit bigger who sends out 1. And then you have the purple dot who sends 2 out, and so on. The third is the betweenness. That is how much are you as a node be, so to say, in between other nodes. I mean, if you follow the path, so you get into me, and how many paths lead out? And here you see, for example, that this one blue dot has 1 going in, but 3 out. So it's pretty in between, I mean, it's really connecting, while these peripheral nodes, I mean, if you cut them off, it's only themselves who are no longer directly connected. And then finally, which is one of the original network metrics used in big data a lot, is the page rank. The page rank is how many referrals do you get? So how many other sites refer to you? It is, in a way, as you see in the dot sizes, similar to the in-degree. And here's the example in sending mail out. It's a real-world example that we did in my company. So you have these different branches of a company, like the development department and the management department. So they send a lot of messages back and forth. The development company never says anything to the help desk, for example, and the help desk has no path back into the development, and the development also hardly ever talks to sales or sales engineering. I mean, here you can clearly see that this company might face, and it was, of course, exactly like that, a huge problem that you have kind of the customer-facing units being totally detached from development. There is no path back, and you have the bottleneck of the management being the only voice to and from development. And that's what you don't want in a company. You want that the help desk can somehow funnel the requests that come in a meaningful way towards development. And sales engineering, that's the guys out at the customer, seeing all the problems facing in deployment, also the concerns that people have, the criticism with the product. I mean, if you don't rely the kind of put that back to development, you will never learn anything. So this is how you use network analysis in a, I would say, good way to understand processes in a company. Here, this is another example. That's a scholarly example. That was a research project at the MIT Media Lab a few years back. That's three branches of a bank, bank in Czechoslovakia, in Czechia. And you clearly see a very similar pattern. That's also mails being sent between people. And you clearly see that there's something going on in the second branch. There's these two clusters that hardly exchange anything. And then looking into that, you would immediately know why, because people in that branch were sitting on two separate floors. And it was different departments sitting. So in the one floor was Department A, and the second floor was Department B. And the management then decided, okay, let's just shuffle people. I mean, we can't change the floors on which people sit, but we can say, let's just put half of the people of Department A on the second floor and half of Department B on the first floor. And immediately communication started to be much, much better. And finally, I mean, one really beautiful analysis that show you the power of network analysis, and also, I mean, how to do it like in a kind of in a meaningful way is this lexicographic analysis of recipes. So this paper scraped all kinds of recipes published on the internet and just looked not which ingredients are in the same recipe, but which other ingredients co-occur. So for example, you don't have, for example, you usually don't have, for example, two different, you don't have, for example, beef and chicken in the same recipe. But beef and chicken usually co-occur with things like onion, pepper, all kinds of spices that are very typical to meat dishes. So it is connecting to a third thing that connects the two. And you see these clusters. Here's the meats, here's the berries, here is the dairies, here's the fish, here's the spices, and so on. And the nice thing is that this analysis was done in many languages without the people doing the analysis knowing these languages. So you would have this analysis go all over the globe, and you can create this kind of connection and find out what a meat is or what a fish is or what dairy is just by looking at the connectivity. So you can look at data without knowing the meaning of it, and then in reverse start understanding what the meaning actually is. This is how they then kind of use to reconstruct the recipes. So you see, for example, in the, I would say generally in the West, we have like egg and flour, egg, flour and butter co-occurring all the time. It's kind of the most published recipes have these ingredients. And you can understand, I mean, really like baking starts with one of these ingredients and then goes on. While in East Asia, where they also did this analysis, you have a totally different set of things starting like with scallion, garlic, onion, and then adding soy sauce and so on, and coming up, so to say, with an algorithm that creates your recipes without knowing anything about what a scallion or garlic is. It makes no assumption on the object. This was a study a friend of mine did that is check-ins in a service called Foursquare in Munich. So and it connects the different points where people kind of consecutively say, I'm here now. It's very similar to the maps I showed you in the beginning. And so what you see here is these clusters of connected locations. And you see that some of the locations are very loosely connected. So very few people go to one location and then to the others after that. So, and there is a lot of politics involved that you could use that, for example, of course, for city planning. You understand the stream of people, the intentions that people have of visiting one thing and then the next, and can think of steering that by offering different public transport systems, or maybe by making it harder to come from one point so easily to the next, and by that getting things more uncluttered. One of the software tools I can recommend using is Giphy. That is an open software tool, everyone can use that, and you put in your data in a very simple form and then get out your beautiful network diagrams. So this flowery or star-like looking structure is an analysis that I did during the Gezi Park unrest in Turkey. So what happened is that people, early on, many people were not so much in favor of Erdogan's politics, in particular in Istanbul. I mean, it's a big city, so you always have these authoritarian regimes and then people opposing them. People expressed their dissatisfaction on Twitter. And what I looked into is kind of these networks of people tweeting with the hashtag Gezi Park. And it's very striking. You see these central nodes that spread information, like, for example, where to gather, where to meet for a protest, and then other networks that are loosely connected. And what I immediately realized in looking into that is, I mean, I can do that. I mean, everyone can. That was open data. Twitter had its API completely open still at that time. So if I can do that, I mean, of course, the Turkish police can do that. The political security services can do that. And you look who is the major tweeters on the topic, and then you look who responds. And then you see also these loose connections that are not so strong, and you can just cut them and make the whole thing fall apart. And this is why it is a political thing. Data science, to understand data science, is a political necessity. It's in the core, really. I mean, people used to say early on, learn to program or be programmed. But actually, that's not true. It's understand information, understand data, or just be dealt with that. I mean, that is the horrible thing. I mean, you cannot reprogram. I mean, there is nothing else we can do. It just look at that and say, oh, that is horrible, actually. We have suddenly a tool that is so powerful for surveillance that it's impossible to bring back. So this call the Soylent Green law of big data. Soylent Green is this science fiction movie from around 1970 where people live in a horribly dystopian world, and then one person suddenly finds out that the horrible food that they get fed is actually the corpses of their deceased. So they say, oh, Soylent Green is made of people, but data is made of people. It is real people's behavior that we are looking at that might reveal the very most intimate things about themselves, and we will be looking at that in the studio sessions in more detail. And if you look at this screenshot, that is Palantir, a very notorious provider of analytic software and database services to intelligence. So Palantir was co-founded by Peter Thiel, who's also one of the driving forces behind Facebook and one of the co-founders of PayPal. Then Peter Thiel started Palantir to kind of disrupt the, in a very conservative way, data is dealt with in governmental organizations. And the NSA at that time was just starting to realize the cyberspace threat. And so it was this post 9/11 obsession with everywhere terrorists are lurking that made the US totally obsessed with collecting all kinds of data, and they couldn't make any sense of it. And Palantir would provide the logic of that. And as you can clearly see, how that looks is very similar than my network diagrams do. So this is how it's actually done. I mean, you realize that a person becomes a terrorist suspect by drawing these connections. It's not just that someone might say something suspicious. You don't care what they say because you might not even understand the language in which they are communicating. But you see, well, this person has been in Yemen, then has been, for example, in India or Pakistan, and then has been in the United States. So that's one thing that you see. And then this person had made phone calls to other people in, for example, the United States and Pakistan at certain times. It's the second factor. And then you would see, well, and this person could obviously pay by their for their plane ticket with cash or whatever. I mean, I'm just making these things up. And then you flag them and say, well, that is a potential terrorist. It might just be totally random, but these patterns are detected by amassing this data in the vaults of the big NSA data center in Salt Lake City. And analysts look at these and decide to whom they send the drone and kill them. I mean, so it is a very serious thing that we are dealing with here. The data that we have amassed or let being collected about ourselves might actually be our death sentence. And I think it is worthwhile seeing that and knowing it and take agency over it. And we will talk about that in the studio sessions, which is the second part of this video. I will introduce you to the basics of smartphone data, tell a bit about storytelling with data, and then show you a very basic text analysis with Python.